Voodoo that winter actually happens in Southern California.
Right? It's like, we're going, it's in the 80s, and all of a sudden California's like, hey, let's try winter for a week. So here we are, guys. Glad you guys are inside, warm and toasty, as well as at home. I'm sure the heater's on there as well, but we're glad that you're here. Hey, friends, if you want to connect with us in any way, a good way to do that is always through our connection card. It's that card right there in front of you. You can fill that out with any questions, prayer requests, praises, or if you want to update any information, you can do that. Fill it out and put it in the little brown box in the foyer. And if you're online, you can always do that by going to our website, thewilliamcappy.com, to that sermon and blog tab, and fill it out that way. Either way, we'd love to connect with you. I have a few announcements for you this morning before we get started. First of which is our winter camp for teens and kids. You can sign up on our Church Center app. A deposit is required, and spaces are limited, so make sure that you get on that as soon as possible. Also, if you haven't gotten one of our hats, our The Well hat for $25, it's a fundraiser for that winter camp. They're still at the gazebo if you'd like to look at that. Also, we have Wednesdays at The Well coming in January. All the 4 weeks of January, we're going to provide dinner for donation, 6 o'clock. The Bible study starts at 7 o'clock. You definitely want to be a part of that. As well as if you still have not signed up for the 25 Gifts of Christmas, that's that text ministry. You sign up on 909-487-1099 and just send a message to, or in the message put 25 gifts. It's a daily scripture and encouragement from one of our pastors. It's not too late. You can definitely sign up for that. So with that being said, I'm going to invite you all to stand just as you guys sit down, and we're going to read our this month's Bible memory verse. Isaiah 9, 6 through 7. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Isaiah 9, 6 through 7. And Father, as always, we are thankful for what you've been doing in our lives. We thank you most of all for your son, Jesus, who came 2,000 years ago, but is still very present in our hearts and our minds and with you in heaven, Lord. We thank you for the ministry throughout our church, Lord, everything that you're doing, Lord. We thank you most of all for this opportunity right now to praise your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Morning, church. So good to see you all. As always, just as we kind of read, the Israelites were in anticipation of the coming Savior. And of course, we today know that Christ has come. Amen. Amen. And we anticipate his return in this season as we celebrate his birth and his coming. So let's sing this together. Let's long for our Lord Jesus together as we worship him. Amen.
Long-expected Jesus, born to set the people free. From our fears and sins, release us. Let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art. Dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom reign. By thine own eternal spirit, in all our hearts alone, by thine all-sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set the people free. From our fears and sins, release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel, strength and consolation, hope of all the earth, thou art dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart.
Israel, strength.
Israel, strength and consolation, hope of all the earth, thou art dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart, joy of every longing heart, joy of every longing heart.
And he is our joy, church. out, churches, our voices.
Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Christ the Lord.
Amen. And church, you may be seated.
Peace.
pray together. Father, we just thank you for this morning, and we thank you for this chance to come together to praise you, Lord. And we are so grateful for what you've done in our lives. And we just ask this morning that as we come together, that you will speak to our hearts today, and that you will help us, Lord, to see you in all that we do. And we just ask, Father, that you would just guide us through this time, that you would speak to us. Lord, just pray that during this Christmas season, we would take some time just to see you in the midst of all the busyness and all the stuff that's going on with Christmas. Lord, help us to not forget that Christ is in the center of that. We ask for you to draw us to yourself during this season. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. So you may have noticed that we forgot to do our offering. So isn't that cool? That seriously, it's like not the biggest thing that we focus on around here. So I tell you what, you guys know the drill, and I'm not even going to talk about it anymore. And if God is leading you to give, just do that. And you know how to do it. You can do it online. If you're here and you'd like to give on the way out, we do have we're going to have our benevolence offering today as well to help those directly in need. And so that money will go directly to those in our congregation who are needing assistance at this time. So that's all I'm going to say about that. All right. So have you ever heard a story that is too incredible to believe? I have heard some before. Boy, I've heard some whoppers. You know, I was a teacher for 21 years. I taught high school. And I've heard every excuse about why students didn't do their homework, you know. And actually, I did have a student tell me that their dog ate it once. And I said, nuh-uh. And they brought in this notebook. It was all chewed to anything. And it was either a two-year-old little brother or a dog. I'm not sure, one of those two. However, I have been known to spin a few yarns myself. And I remember once in the Air Force, I was late to work. And they don't take too kindly to that for some odd reason. I don't know. The military, they have all these rules and stuff. And but I told them that I was kidnapped on the way to work. And I told this long story of like 43 South Moluccan terrorists took me, and I was just 15 minutes late, but I told them I got away. It was a great story. They did not believe me, not for a second. So, but today we're going to look at a story that is crazy by human standards. The standards of this world that we live in, if you were to tell someone this story was going on, you know what people would say? They'd say, nuh-uh. And I know that's true because I've told people this and they've said, nuh-uh. And so I think that I want you just to understand how incredible this story is and how unlikely and how totally, incredibly miraculous this is. Because it is not just a story that anyone could just make up. This actually happened, but it's incredibly wild. Now, you remember last week we talked about Zechariah and Elizabeth and how they had a baby when they were really, really old? Well, the story continues on in the first chapter of Luke. After that story, something else happened with Elizabeth's cousin that was even more amazing than Zechariah and Elizabeth's story. And so if you have your Bibles, open to Luke chapter 1, verse 26. And Luke is the second of the Gospels in the New Testament. The New Testament starts with Matthew, and then, or it's actually the third one, sorry. There's Matthew, Mark, and then Luke, all right? I've really been studying this stuff for 45 years, so you'd think I would probably get that right. But Luke is the third Gospel, all right? And he tells from a different perspective than everyone else. Luke was a doctor, very meticulous in the way that he recorded things. And he also wasn't Jewish. He was probably
a Gentile who wrote this, which was very different, a different perspective of things. So in Luke chapter 1, verse 26, Luke the doctor, he writes this. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, kind of tying us over from last week's story, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee. Now, 6 months along in the pregnancy, everyone's aware of what's happening, and sent the angel Gabriel. Remember, Gabriel was in the last story as well. Gabriel was kind of a busy guy around this time. And Gabriel is the one who he was the great one of God. And it's interesting that he began this story with such precision. There's times, there's places. And actions that God did. And it starts out kind of with Mary's story. This is kind of the beginning part of Mary's story. You guys all know about Mary. But he begins with the place. And the place that God began all of this, you would think that it would be someplace spectacular. But actually, the place was Galilee and not Judea. Galilee was kind of an area of the Holy Land, and it was known as Galilee of the Gentiles. It was known as the place where people who were not the in crowd hung out. Because the in crowd, as you know, in this story, were the Jewish people. And God began this story in an area that wasn't really the most Jewish place of all. It was up in Galilee. It was kind of the working class place. You know, if you would think that if God was going to do a great work in the United States, he would go someplace like L.A. or New York or Chicago or Dallas, you know, one of the big, big cities. But it's like God sent this angel to Arkansas. It was a little bit different than what you would imagine if God, that God was going to do. But it was also to a specific city. And he sent the angel to Nazareth, not Jerusalem. And that's kind of interesting. Because in Nazareth, you know, it's It wasn't really a podunk village. There was about 15,000 people at this place. It was kind of for that area, kind of a big little village. It was a center of commerce and trade. But the reason that Nazareth was well-renowned is because it was pretty decadent kind of a place. At the time, it was known like Las Vegas. If Jesus was supposed to come back to the earth right now, you would think that he probably wouldn't go to Vegas. It's hard to imagine Jesus saying, I'm coming back again in Vegas, baby. You know? Of course, Vegas is the place for people making a big comeback. Everyone whose career kind of fizzled out, they lay low for about 10 years and then go to Vegas and and get paid a gazillion dollars. For the people who used to like them, who used to, anyways. So you see, it's interesting. It was referred to by Nathanael the apostle. Remember when they said Jesus came from Nazareth? Nathanael's response was, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Now, I don't know if you've been to Vegas or not. I've been there. And if someone said the Messiah is coming, he's coming from Vegas, I would say, can anything good come out of Vegas? But that's what Nathanael thought about Jesus. And it wasn't really referring to geography as much as sociology. What was going on in the society of that area? And so Nazareth was just not the kind of place, if your kid grew up, you would say, oh, I hope you go off and go to college in Nazareth. It would not be your first choice. And then the other thing here is this angel we're going to see in a minute, came to Mary's home and not the temple. God is doing everything a little bit different than what we have it expected to be. You know, as we try to figure out what God's going to do next, so oftentimes we're wrong. Because God does his own thing according to his own plan and his own agenda. He has reasons behind all of the different things that he's doing. And a lot of times he will go and deal with us personally rather than corporately. I think God is more concerned about what's going on in your hearts right now than he is concerned about what's the course of America. Now, I think that there's a direct correlation between what's going on in our hearts and what's happening in America. You know, that Old Testament scripture doesn't say, if all the pagans who really hate me would all of a sudden turn their hearts to God, the country would be better. It's not what the Old Testament promise says. The Old Testament promise says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, and I will hear from heaven and I'll heal their land. The call first is for us individually. And so God comes and visits Mary in her home, not in the temple. It's not about what mega church you go to. It's not about what small local church you go to. It's about what God is doing in your hearts. And God will even work outside of his own institutions when we degrade them. So he came to Mary's house. In Luke 1:27, the next verse says that God sent the angel to Nazareth, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. So the place was Nazareth. The people begin with Mary. She was a virgin, a parthenos, which is the Greek word, means virgin. Someone that had not had sexual relationships with anyone at that time. And it has no other meaning. I mean, there's no, you can't really, and this is kind of the weird part of this story, the unbelievable part. This name is the same as Moses' sister Miriam, by the way, same root word, and it's closely, you know, both of them are closely related to a deliverer. Moses was seen as a deliverer. Jesus is a deliverer. And the name means exalted, it means lifted up. In fact, in Isaiah, you know, hundreds of years, like 800 years before Jesus came, Isaiah prophesied and said in verse, in Isaiah 7:14, Isaiah said, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. See, that was Jesus. He's here. He's with us. He's God here with us. And this is kind of a weird story that a virgin is going to conceive and have a baby. That doesn't happen very often. Like ever. And Mary was an example of a godly, lovely young woman in the midst of a God-rejecting society. And all of a sudden, she finds herself pregnant. This angel says, he came to her and began to say some things. We're going to look at that in just a second. And then there's also Joseph who's part of this. They were engaged. He was just a normal dude. In Matthew 8:55. It records that they said, is this not, talking about Jesus, is this not the carpenter's son? Joseph was just a hardworking tradesman. He was a guy that worked with his hands. Probably Joseph was a carpenter, but he could have been a stonemason or a general contractor. It's not totally exactly clear in that what that word carpenter could mean, any of those different things. But could you imagine his dilemma? He's engaged to a girl. He's following God. She supposedly is following God, and now she's pregnant. That would cause stress in the relationship. And he must have been a good man, or God would not have entrusted him to raise his son. And I just have a special place in my heart for all you stepfathers out there, you guys who have stepped in and assumed the role of raising children. And I know I've been the benefit of that, and I have a stepfather who adopted me. And man, it's a hard road. And he probably died early on in Jesus' life, because it doesn't mention anything else about him after these early parts of the story. After Jesus was 12 or 13, there's no more mention of Joseph. So we have a God who steps into this world knowing a little bit about pain. He was actually in a blended family when he first came to this earth, our God Jesus. The third character in this story is Gabriel, God's hero, and we talked about him last week. But you know, when God had a tough job to do on the earth, he called Gabriel or Michael. These were the guys, these were his go-to guys on the earth to really deliver messages and get things done. So let's peek in on the conversation that the three of these were having. Okay, so that's the backdrop of the story. Here's the conversation in Luke 1:28. The angel went to her, went to Mary, and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored." It's like good news and bad news. You know when your boss calls you in and says something really nice about you, and then you know that there's that three-letter word coming, but greetings, who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. And it says, Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. So she was kind of like, okay. And there it is, this next word in verse 30. But the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." So this communication and this promise from the angel, you know, hail favored, when God is chosen, you're favored, you're picked out over all the earth, and you're going to have a child. Now, he went into more details in some of the other gospels and kind of told her, this is going to be conceived by God. And I don't know how all that worked out. I mean, you know, all the details are kind of shrouded in a mystery for us. But the promise was, the Lord is with you. And it was pretty disconcerting to her, but the angel reassured her of God's favor and God's grace in her life. You're going to conceive, you're going to call him Jesus, it says, in other words, meaning Savior. You're going to call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. And he's going to save us from self and sin and a sick world. And the promise is, you're going to give birth. He's going to be the Son of God. And he's going to rule from David's throne. It's crazy. Do you imagine this poor little girl? She's probably like 15 or 16 years old. And this angel's appearing and saying all this stuff. Now, that's pressure. If you've had children, you know the pressure that is, because you're wondering, this little kid, you know, I remember holding our firstborn just, and she was tiny, you know, 5 pounds and 13 ounces, just this little peanut, you know, and I was wondering, what in the world, how am I supposed to take care of this? And what is she going to grow up to be? And I had a lot of questions. Mary, in verse 34, began to ask a few questions. You know, there was a promise, but there was also a question. And the question was kind of this obvious one in verse 34. How will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I'm a virgin? You know, I took that seventh grade class at the junior high school, and they told me how this was going to happen, but that's not happening. How will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I'm a virgin? How will this be? That's the obvious question. How is this going to happen? And when we see our life's circumstances unfolding before us, a lot of times we ask that question. How is this going to be? How are you going to work that out, God? It's the obvious question. And it really wasn't a question of disbelief, but she really wanted some further instruction. She wasn't saying, I don't believe you, but I want to know how this is all going to work out. And I think we have the same questions now. We ask questions like this: God, how can you live inside of us? The Bible teaches that the Holy Spirit indwells in us. And the Holy Spirit, he lives in us. And we're born again. How can this be? How can the perfect dwell inside of this imperfect person? Nicodemus asked the same question in John chapter 3. How can I be born again? Do I go back in my mother's womb and be born again that way? And Jesus patiently explained to him what it meant to be born again. But we have these kind of questions. But really the same answer to all of these questions is found in verses 35 to 37 right here. In Luke 1:35, it says, the angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. In verse 36, he continued on and said, even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she, who is said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. And I love this next promise. For no word of God will ever fail. When God says something, it's going to happen, and he's going to make sure that it comes to pass. And so the answer is very simple. Nothing in verse 35, the answer here is nothing is impossible with God. God's answer to Mary and to the answer to her question is simply this, is my Holy Spirit will do it. It's not by might, it's not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. So I don't know everything that's going on in all of your lives. Each of you has challenges that are difficult for you in your lives. And they may seem to be challenges that are insurmountable. They may seem to be challenges that you can't get past. How is it going to happen? Well, God's promise is that he's going to walk with you through all of it. Even through the valley of the shadow of death, he's going to walk with you, and he's going to do it through his Holy Spirit. And that's the way that it's going to happen. The same answer. Holy Spirit's going to do it. God's answer to Nicodemus about being born again, he said, you're going to be born again by the Spirit. God's answer to us when we ask, how is the Son of God going to be revealed in me? It's the same answer, by the power of his Spirit. How does salvation happen? By His Spirit. How does sanctification happen? By His Spirit. How do we engage in service for the sake of the kingdom? It's by His Spirit working inside of us through spiritual gifts. Specifically at the well, you know, our thing that we say is we're to connect, grow, and... Right, those three things, how do you do them? You do it by the Spirit of God working in you. If you try to do it on your own, you're going to burn out and fall down. If you allow God's Spirit to move you, to empower you, and to lead you, you're going to have exactly what you need to accomplish what God has for you, and it's by relying on His Spirit. And if you look at verse 37, there's that assurance of God. There's no word from God is ever going to fail if we lean into His Spirit. And verse 37 is just, you know, in this whole context, and He says, you know, this your cousin is old, and she's 6 months pregnant at this point. God used an old barren woman to comfort a young scared girl. And see, that's what this is about. That's why you need church, by the way. Because we need to encourage one another. You know, we young guys have to learn from the old guys. Amen. It's true. But look at Mary's response, and this is really amazing. Here's what Mary said. In light of all this stuff, I mean, she just heard some pretty big, disturbing news that's going to turn her world upside down. She understood all of the social ramifications of what was about to happen. But in the middle of that, look at her response in verse 38. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. She didn't come up with a million excuses why she couldn't do it. She didn't explain to God why this was a bad idea. She just said, I'm the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled. And the angel left her. He's like, okay then. My work here is done. Look at her response. She responded in two ways here that are just amazing. First, she said, I'm the Lord's servant. This Greek word means that she's a willing slave. She was a Greek word is a doulos, a bond servant. Totally giving up her own will. And she didn't give it up to a person or to a church, but to God. What would our lives be like if we totally gave ourselves over to the will of God? What would it be like? It's hard. That's a hard thing to do. Just totally give yourself to God and say, Lord, whatever the consequences, whatever the circumstances, I am yours. I'm your servant. So that was her first response, I'm your servant. The second is, may it be to me as you have said. Can let it happen, Lord, bring it on. You said it, let's do it, go ahead. I'm your servant, let it happen. And I think this prayer breathes out the secret of salvation and our sanctification and our servants to God. It's the essence of growing and connecting and serving, and it's just that one phrase, and I like the way it says in the King James Version, not my will, but thine be done. Not my will, but thine. Not mine, but thine. That needs to be like our credo of our lives. Not mine, but thine. Because God's going to lead you in areas that you don't really want to go. Have you seen that to be true? There, when I first got saved, if God said, this is going to be your path, I'd say, nah, I see that, and I see that, and I see that. I'm not doing that. But we come back, not mine, but thine. And you know, that essence of not really wanting to follow through when you see that things are going to be hard, that's nothing new. And that's not really sin. It's not sin. Jesus, in the Garden of Gethsemane, the night before he was crucified, he knew what was coming. And he said, Lord, if there's any other way to do this, please do that, please. I don't want to go on a cross. And the Father said, no, you're going, this is it. We've talked about this, Junior. And Jesus said, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. It's no sin to wrestle a little bit with God. But at the end, we have to come to that place, not mine, but thine. And as Jacob can attest, you know, he wrestled with God through the night, and he ended up with a broken hip. And I think all of us enter heaven with a limp. I think we're limping when we get in, because not just all the stuff we've been through, but the times we wrestled with God, every once in a while he has to dislocate our hip to get our attention. Not my will, but thine be done. So what was going on with Joseph at this time? So Mary was having her struggles, and these guys were just engaged little kids. Joseph probably is 20 or so, and Mary's probably 15 or 16, you know, the little kids. So what was going on with Joseph? What's his story? The Gospel of Matthew tells his story, and an angel appeared to him as well. But let's take a look at this video clip. We're going to dim the lights up here, and we're going to turn on a video clip of Joseph's story. And again, this is a dramatic interpretation, okay? So So you could imagine the difficulty that both of these two young kids had to go through. And we see at the end that it's kind of the same story for each of us. God comes to our door and he knocks, and we have to answer. Do we open that door and let him in or not? So this was a family in need of support, and God provided the support that they needed. And God will provide that support in your life too. And oftentimes he does it by using others who go through similar experiences, as God did for Mary right at that moment. And Mary needed some support. And so who in the world could support Mary through this miraculous intervention? I think the most obvious person would be Elizabeth, her cousin, right? Because she'd been through something with an angel, just kind of the opposite end of her life, but just as miraculous nonetheless. Look at verses 39 to 45 in Luke chapter 1. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" That's pretty encouraging, because the angel told Mary that she's going to be the mother of the Son of God. And so now Elizabeth is confirming that by saying, "The mother of my Lord is coming here to my house." That was really great words of affirmation to Mary. Verse 44, "As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." So we see now this interaction of Mary and Elizabeth. We see them coming together in these verses. And God supported Mary by sending her to her relative Elizabeth's house. And we're going to look at the Magnificat. In Latin, means the glorify. There are 15 quotes from the Old Testament that Mary says in response to the Holy Spirit. And there's many ways to study this, but I want to focus on one thing in the middle of this, and it's focus on the joy of Mary. Because Mary had a lot of joy in the middle of this verses. And she says this in verse 46 through 50. It says, "Mary said, 'My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. And from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation.'" See, this joyful exclamation of Mary at this point says some really cool things. But it's all rooted in joy. You see, first in verse 47, there's a spiritual joy. All these gifts filled her soul and made her spirit sing. She was having spiritual joy in the middle of a very difficult situation in her life. The second thing is that her joy was in God. Verse 47 again, "My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior." It comes from this knowledge of him, and not knowledge about him, but knowledge of him. It's not that we know all about God, it's that we know God. And we can have joy in the middle of difficult situations. The third thing is joy in her salvation. "My Savior, Jesus." Verse 47, "God, my Savior." She was bearing the Savior, and she knew it. And it gave her joy. The fourth thing, joy in praise. And this was directed in verse 46. She was saying, my soul glorifies the Lord. See, her joy was praising God, and it was directed at God because she knew who he was. Verse 48, it was a grateful joy. She was very grateful. He's been mindful of the humble state of his servant. See, God was giving her blessings in the middle of her difficulties, and she was grateful for it. And next time you're in a difficult situation, instead of focusing on the difficulty, look at how God is sustaining you in the middle of your difficulties. And try to cultivate an attitude of gratitude inside of your heart. Ask yourself this question, what in the middle of this circumstance can I be grateful for? It's not easy because it's counterintuitive. The thing that we want to do is we want to complain. Lord, this is hard. This is terrible. It's awful. No one in the history of all awfulness have been treated this awful. Mary had a lot of reason to complain. This is an unprecedented, you know, I hear this all the time about the COVID thing. This is unprecedented. Well, hogwash, it's not unprecedented. It's precedented. It's happened throughout history. There's always been this stuff going on. It's not unprecedented. But what might be unprecedented is how you can begin to look for opportunities to be grateful in the midst of difficulties. And maybe you have an unprecedented response to a load of, you know, whatever. All right. She was grateful. She was deeply conscious of her need and how God was filling the needs in her life. And then she had this hopeful joy. She said, all generations will call me blessed. In verse 48, the sixth thing here, hopeful joy. It was hopeful for what was going to happen. She saw a future of blessedness. You know, I think Christians tend to make two mistakes about Mary. On one hand, we could venerate her so much that you end up praying to her instead of to God. There's no place in the Bible that says pray to Mary. Then say that. I get it. I know why you would want to, but it just doesn't say to do that in the scriptures. But on the other hand, in reaction to that, many of our Protestant friends have totally ignored Mary. But I got to tell you, she's something. You want to study a Christian life that lifts up God in the midst of trials. You look at Mary's life, she is a great example. And you know, God must have thought very highly of her to choose her to be the mother of Jesus. Excuse me. And her legacy has lasted forever. And trust me, friends, if you want to talk about your legacy and what you're going to leave behind on this earth, is that our nearness to Christ will be the enduring legacy of our lives. That's what people are going to remember you for. And then the last thing here is she had a reasonable joy. You know why it was reasonable? Because he had done great things for her. That's what she says in verse 49. For the mighty one has done great things for me. What are the great things that God has done in your life? If you spend time trying to find them, you will find them. We you know, a lot of times we just choose like all the cruddy stuff that's happening. We focus on that. It's like, it's been this and this and this and this and this and this and this. But man, I tell you, in the middle of that, there's good stuff. You know, your life is like a double stuffed Oreo. You endure those cookies on the outside to get to that double stuffed good stuff in the middle. That's why when your kids are little, you unseparate it, you eat the white stuff, put it back together, and give them a cookie, you know? Not that I've ever done such a thing. But I want to go back to verse 50 and read through verse 55. Because God tells us two more good things about God here. These verses have revealed two more good things about him. Ready? In verse 50, his mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones and lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful, and to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors. It's a couple of things right here that I want you to see. And as we're going forth in this world that is really jacked up, okay, the world's a mess. It really is. I don't know anyone that's saying, man, these are the best of times. Haven't heard that lately. Everyone says, I am so happy to be living in 2021. I haven't heard that. But in the middle of that, there's two things we can remember and we can hang on to. First is the power of God. In the middle of all these difficulties, it says in verse 50, in 51, he scatters the proud. He brought down the rulers and he sent the rich away empty-handed. See, God is not dependent upon any political power. He's not dependent upon any money. He's not dependent on anything because he is sufficient within himself. And the power of God will see to it in your lives that you can accomplish all that God has intended for you to accomplish. The power of God is in your life. He's with you and he's backing you up. And that's good to know, because there's a lot of, I keep wanting to say words that I cannot say right here, okay? There's a lot of stuff going on that is just bad, but the power of God is greater than all of this hooey that is going on around us. That's a word I can say, hooey. The power of God is stronger than the hooey of the world. The second thing is the grace of God. God is not only powerful and righteous and mighty and just, but he also is graceful. He is full of grace. He exalts the humble. The ones who bow to him, he will lift up. He fills the hungry, physically and spiritually. Are you hungering after something that this world is not delivering? Then turn your hunger and the object of your need to God, and he will fill you. And he gives help to his servants. And in all these events that we've just read about, we see in Joseph and Mary's life, we see the power and the grace of God helping them through a really, really difficult situation. So what's the conclusion to this? Verse 56. Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. So Elizabeth was 6 months pregnant. Mary got there. I don't know if she stayed for the baby being born and then took off. Said, whoa, this is what's coming. I'm out of here. Don't want none of that. But for whatever reason, she left. And that ends this incredible story. It's a wild story. Who would have believed it? That these two women, both of their stories got together. It's like craziness. And all that we've read today is just a mystery. It's beyond comprehension if you try to figure out all the little details of how this happened. Mary said it best in her question, how can this be? How could it happen that the Christ, the Savior, God himself was formed in the womb of a woman? How could that be? The Creator was in the process of being created by the one created by him. It's mind-boggling. And that's an incredible story, but it's not finished yet. As we leave here today, we need to reflect on what God has said. And because the same Jesus that was alive in Mary at this time can live in you today. Same one. We are the temple of God, where God abides. We are the possessors of the Holy Spirit. He's taken up residence within us. God Himself is living within you. And the Apostle Paul wrote in Colossians 1:27, he said, Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's the hope of glory for the world, is Christ alive in you. And that's how people will know that God is real and He exists. Jesus living through us is the hope of glory, and indeed it's the only hope of mankind. It's the hope of the world right here, and it's in you. For this generation, for this time, for this place, you are the ones who are bringing Christ to this world. And as Christ is being formed within us, we too are being formed by Christ. And so my question that I end the sermon today, and this is what I want you to think about this week. I want you to take this with you. I want you to lock it into your noggins. You ready? How is Christ forming in you today? And what difference does that make in the world? We're going to take communion today. And communion is a time to remember what God has done. I want you to remember what God did through this miraculous time of Christmas. How He came to this earth as a baby, was formed inside of a woman, and then he grew up as a perfect person, and he lived a sinless life, and He was crucified on a cross to pay for our sins. And He calls us today to remember that. He calls us to remember it through the broken bread and through the fruit of the vine. And He calls us to remember the blood and the body of Jesus today. And it's a call to remember the reality that these are not just miraculous stories. These are real things that really, really happened. And this is a tangible reminder of that. So let's pray together and let's take communion together. Father, we just thank You this morning for what You've done. We thank You that You defied all logic. You defied all of natural physical law to come to earth and to be God with us, Emmanuel. And so, Father, as we take communion this morning, I pray that we will remember that it wasn't just about the baby in the manger, but it was about the Savior on the cross. Help us this Christmas, Lord, to remember that Christ is in us and that we through that are the hope of the world. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, sacred and now shame weighed down, now scornfully surrounded with thorns, Thine only crown. Oh, sacred head, what glory, what bliss till now was Thine. Yet though despised and gory, our joy to call Thee mine, our joy to call Thee mine. Oh Lord, Thou hast suffered, was all for sinners came. In mine was the transgression, but thine the deadly pain. Lo, here I fall, my Savior, 'tis I deserve thy place. Look on me with thy favor, vouchsafe to me thy grace. Vouchsafe to me thy grace.
And as we read through what Paul's instructions to the church at Corinth were, he said, I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Lord, we remember all of the great miracles that you've done. And Lord, the miracle that you would give yourself for us is the greatest of all. And we thank you for that. We ask, Father, that as we remember what you've done, Lord, that we put our faith in you and in what you have done for us. And Lord, not that you just that you died for us, but also that you raised from the dead. And that gives us hope, and that's a promise for us. So we celebrate, we remember, we look back on what you have done. But also, Lord, we remember your promise for the future, that this brokenness leads to resurrection. And Lord, we await that day. We thank you for the resurrection that's happened in our lives. And we ask, Father, that we would trust and rest in that. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You were forsaken.
let's sing the rest of that, Brandon. Go ahead, the chorus to that.
Amazing love.
Amazing love. How can it be that you, my king, would die for me? Amazing love.
And he said to the Corinthians, in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Lord, we celebrate your first coming during this time of year, but Lord, we anticipate your second coming every day. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. Thank you for this new covenant in your blood that assures us of a life with you. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand together and let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time that we had together. We thank you that you came to this scared little girl and Lord, you changed the course of history. You altered our destiny and you provided us a way to escape the clutches of the evil one, to live a life that ultimately will lead eternally to you. So today we ask, Father, that you would be formed in us just as you were formed in Mary, Lord. That you would be formed in us, that each of us would be formed in you. Help us to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Help us to live our lives in service to you. Not our will, but thine be done. In Jesus' name, amen. Don't forget on your way out, we have a benevolence offering, and that will help those in need that are in our congregation during this Christmas time. God bless you all. We'll see you next week. Lord willing.
Let's sing, church.
Conquered.
Church, he is our hope. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All praise to the King of Kings, the Father of all glory. May God bless you. May God keep you. Hey, Bob.